Listener, Twitter is my name, and I've been working on a project of evaluation of Sentinel-3 derived water quality parameters for Lake Victoria under the supervision of Associate Professor Anthony Gidudu and Madam Letaru Lydia. We all know about Lake Victoria. It is a transboundary supply of water which cuts across Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania, with Uganda occupying around 45% of Lake Victoria, 6% goes to Kenya, then 49% to Tanzania. So about Lake Victoria, it has a lot of importance that it enables the community around through fishing activities, also providing water for domestic use, commercial purposes, and all that. So traditionally, water quality monitoring has been happening, but it employs local methods, which involve going to the field and they collect water samples on the lake. And these methods are usually hectic, cumbersome, and they are too costly in terms of operational costs. And that raises a bit of awareness that can't we have other methods that we can use to be able to retrieve this kind of information? And this is where remote sensing comes in, whereby we can be able to obtain information on the ground without being in direct contact with the phenomena that we are trying to look at. So remote sensing has been carried out. This is not the first study to be carried on Lake Victoria. People have conducted research on Lake Victoria. However, employing other imagery like MODIS. But in this research, we are trying to look at Sentinel-3 specifically, which was launched in 2016. That is satellite A, Sentinel-3A, then Sentinel-3B, which was launched in 2018. So like I've talked about the relevance attached to lakes in Lake Victoria, having all those advantages, it has been increasingly, there has been an increasing interest in the concern regarding water quality. So with that, there is a need for looking at the water quality of a lake, which is particularly Lake Victoria. That's why in this research, we are trying to look at how Sentinel-3, how good is it in regards to estimation of the parameters that we are going to look at. And when we look at the objectives, the main objective of this study, we are trying to evaluate the Sentinel-3 derived water quality parameters based on the in-situ observations. And specifically, we are trying to look at, we want to evaluate the retrieval algorithms for chlorophyll A. We look at the search depth, then as well as lake surface temperature. Then the justification for this work, we have an institute called NAFIRI, that is National Resource Research, Fisheries Resource Research Institute, which is based in Jinja, that has been responsible for the generation of knowledge and technologies in regards to management and conservation of fisheries. So with this kind of project, they have been responsible for the data collection or regarding the status of the water quality. So this project is going to feed them information on how well Sentinel-3 can perform in regards to retrieval of water quality parameters. So that is the area study, which is Lake Victoria, and that blue track is the path that was taken while collecting the field data. Then the methodology of this work, we have data collection, whereby now we need two kinds of data sets. We have in situ observations and satellite derived. Satellite imagery, which is Sentinel-3. And Sentinel-3, we have two sensors, that is OLCI, Ocean Land Color Imager Instrument, which gives us the imagery that is specifically looking at how we can retrieve search depth and chlorophyll A. Then we also have an instrument called Sea and Land Surface Temperature Radiometer that is responsible for lake surface temperature, which has the thermal bands. So now, after the satellite imagery, you know, this is an optical sensor whereby we have a high element of cloud cover, which always affects the remote sensing aspect. And now, after filtering out, we have to look at the cloud cover. Are our in-situ observations affected by cloud cover? If not, we go to pre-processing. Pre-processing involves the subsetting of the image to make sure it covers our study area, as well as the transformation, because the way we pick coordinates on the ground, the image comes in WGS84. So we have to make sure they are in the same system for comparison. Then after that, we look at the image that is gotten from the sea surface temperature radiometer. We can be able to get We can extract land surface temperature for the lake, chlorophyll A, and we can also apply KD90 algorithm to the band that contains diffusion coefficients for attenuation. Then, meaning we have such depth, we have lake surface temperature as well as chlorophyll A, which we are going to look at also in situ observations that were picked. Then that will be subjected under statistical analysis where we look at various indicators. As we can see, we have root mean square error, we have relative percentage difference bias, and the Pearson correlation coefficient. Now, it is after that two kind of data sets that we are able to validate the data, which will enable us to get our objective, number one, two, and three. So, and the results, we are looking at chlorophyll A results. The orange line corresponds to what is picked from the satellite, and the blue line corresponds to what is picked from the ground. So, generally, when we look at what is actually on that bar graph, we can see that actually the satellite live data quality parameter for chlorophyll A is higher than the one from the ground generally, which means it is being overestimated with a root mean square of 2.04 milligrams per liter, which is not bad according to the studies that have happened. Then we as well have such depth, which we can see from that bar graph that the in situ observations are actually above the satellite derived parameters, giving us an indication in the back of our mind that actually the satellite derived parameters for such depth are below the ones that are picked from the ground, which means that actually it is being underestimated. What is coming from the satellite is below what is from the ground, with a root mean square error of 0.74 meters. Then we also look at lake surface temperature. Generally, or from that bar graph, we can be able to realize that actually in situ observations are a bit higher than what is coming from the satellite. In this regard, we can be able to obtain values of lake surface temperature with a root mean square of 0.69 degrees centigrade, which is good for operational use. However, the correlation coefficient here that we have with lake surface temperature is 0.61. Then for such depth is 0.71, and then for chlorophyll A it is 0.69. Now, when you look at those values, you look at the actual lake surface temperature is 0.6, which is a bit lower than other parameters. Why? We have in lake surface temperature, we are this kind of sensor gives data in a resolution of 1 kilometer. However, this kind of information that the data that was used for this had a pixel of 4 by 4 kilometers, because we used level 3 products, which are daily composites of the information that you retrieved. So with that, we can be able to have an understanding from the results that we have. It is realized that Sentinel-3 can actually accurately model up the parameters for water quality, which are chlorophyll A, such depth, and lake surface temperature. Then therefore, more research is recommended so that we can look at various algorithms that are specific to Lake Victoria, because we have a challenge whereby these algorithms that we are used to retrieve this information are ocean-based. So that is the challenge. And the main challenge in this kind of study was cloud cover, since the image we are using here is optical, the sensors are optical, so that is the main challenge we have been having in this study. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Prince, for that delightful presentation. So at this juncture, I would like to invite some one or two questions to Prince to just clarify on what he has presented. Okay, as the maybe questions come in, Prince, we observed that there's some deviance between the in situ and the satellite derived. What would you think may it be the possible causes for this deviation from your interaction with this study?
According to the data that we are displaying here, we are looking at this orange line being the satellite derived and this blue being the in situ observation. Now the challenge comes in when you're using an algorithm to retrieve chlorophyll, because here we use an algorithm which is it is called Ocean Color Climate Change Initiative algorithm of version 5, and it is usually specifically designed for oceans, and Lake Victoria that we are looking at is just a lake. So by using that kind of algorithm, it has already parameters that are not specifically tuned to suit our region, which is Lake Victoria. And another thing we are having is the in-situ point that is picked is particularly on a given point. So if I get a value of 2 on a particular point, and here we are looking at a pixel of 300 meters by 300 meters, which is Sentinel-3, the resolution for ocean land color imager instrument. 300 by 300 meters, you see, according to that point you've picked specifically in field, and you're saying the image, the value you're considering for that particular pixel is 300 by 300 meters, automatically it cannot give that same value. Those are the differences that come in there.
Okay, from the audience, anyone with a question? Yeah, so maybe lastly, maybe to clarify for the audience there, an attempt has been done to model a chlorophyll A using other satellite imagery. Maybe just to re-clarify, why would one want Sentinel-3? I know you tried to attempt to discuss it. So yeah, I'd also just clarify on what you mean by such depth with comparison to normal depth. To just
all right. Thank you for your question. Now, by such depth, you see when light rays come and they penetrate through a water column, there's a particular point where you cannot see what is happening down there. And now we measure this using certain instrument called a search disk, as illustrated here in our right corner. I mean our right bottom corner, we can see that image. So you lower your disk into a water column, then it keeps moving down as you notice it. It keeps moving down as you notice. It will reach a particular point whereby the right ray is coming from above, hitting it and making you see it. It will be at a point whereby you're seeing it and it is almost going. That is the point, that is the depth that you measure from that particular point where it is disappearing up to the height of the water surface. That is what we can look at as, that's what is measured as such depth.